Today we're talking about Trump's trade policies again. Oh man, the best coverage of this subject so far has come from a Katy Perry song I don't own the license to. You're hot, then you're cold, you're yes, then you're no, you're in, then you're out, and you're up, and then you're down. So today we're talking about how the US just imposed sanctions on Canada, Mexico, and the EU. And wait, I'm sure I've talked about this before. Most people think that Donald Trump is using these tariffs as leverage to renegotiate the NAFTA, or North American Free Trade Agreement, which is kind of like threatening to shoot someone if they don't loosen gun bans. Well, those negotiations are working out great. Since that report, we've announced none of this applies to our allies. Then, about a month after that, it was announced these tariffs would be attached to our allies at a delayed date. But guess what, guys? The day of reckoning has come. Probably. After seeing us take every position in the recent trade war with China, which was about as much a trade war as MTV is a music channel, I'm not sure if we can still have the same opinions regarding our allies 3 hours after I published this piece. This is important to report though, because even if this goes nowhere, well, we're still putting our allies through the ringer. It would be like if I punched my friend in the dick and then said, bro, it's a prank. I got you good. Alright, so first, let's see what's actually happening. And then after that, see what people on both sides are saying is happening.
Well, the U.S. has announced that Canada's exemption from steel and aluminum tariffs is over. With NAFTA talks stalled, the tariff exemption for this country and Mexico expires tonight at midnight. The European Union is also affected.
As you can imagine, those tariffs are now in place, as well as $50 billion in tariffs against China, which the Chinese government has said are obviously in violation of the consensus reached in Washington recently by both China and the United States. Yeah, you remember when 10 days ago we reached an agreement to postpone the tariffs for negotiations to proceed? Neither does the president. Alright, so as you can imagine, nobody is very pleased with any of this. So now to Fox News with their coverage.
This was not something that was nobly greeted, by the way, in the financial markets. The president making good on his tariff threats with those companies, countries that send us a lot of steel and aluminum.
Oh, geez. If this is Neil Cavuto down this much, I'd hate to see how Rachel Maddow is taking it. Anyways, yes, financial markets were not rallying around the prospect of a trade war. Although, at this point, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me maybe 5 times, and we won't dip that much. He went on to say,
this isn't really an opening salvo to China. It's meant more to hurt the Mexicans and the Canadians and the Europeans. None of them seem to like it. Already indications that Germany plans a response. Canada saying much the same. The Mexicans have been quiet, but they are not going quietly when it comes to a response to this eventually.
Great. Now these prepared tariffs are surprisingly hilarious, with Europe threatening a 25% tariff on American-made denim, cigarettes, cranberry juice, peanut butter, and motorcycles. Europe, I think you got your grocery and sanctions list mixed up. Also, expensive denim, cigarettes, and motorcycles? Europe, I think you're annoying a very specific demographic that you probably want to keep happy. In the same vein, Mexico has said they're introducing tariffs on American lamps, pork, fruit, cheese, and flat steel. Really? Starting your list with lamps? Although, you might be needing all the lamps you can get with all that shade your politicians are throwing around. Now, Neil did have a former State Department representative on the show to explain.
Slapping tariffs on some of your closest allies, I think, is not a smart policy. In my view, we should focus on China, which has been cheating.
Yes, China is the real threat. And surprising everyone except probably Iran, we're breaking our negotiated trade resolutions and starting the trade war with them all over. Great, it looks like they intend on slapping additional tariffs on our aircrafts, automobiles, and soybeans, which are actually pretty large exports, despite the fact that I haven't eaten a soybean since I graduated out of eating Gerber Baby.
So I think imposing these steel tariffs on some of our closest allies with whom we should be working to push back on China is not the right way to go.
What are you talking about? Declaring war on everyone gives you the best odds of success. Just ask. Nope, he lost. Hey, he lost too. He shot himself in the head in his bunker. Yeah, maybe that's not a good idea. So, what she's saying is that we need to work with our friends to try to put more pressure on China in the negotiating table. Sounds reasonable, but I want to hear an argument for why we should be doing all this. Next Fox News anchor.
I was surprised. I went into the World Trade Organization stats on tariffs around the world. The Europeans have tens of thousands of tariffs on U.S. products. So it's not as though, you know, we're loading on something that they don't have against us. On the other hand, people say we're close to full employment in the United States. We've got record growth going on here. We don't want to upset the apple cart now with these tariffs.
All right. We found our advocate. Now, this probably won't surprise you, but I too went to look at the WTO statistics, and let me tell you definitively, this is really complicated. He wasn't exaggerating when he said 10,000 small charges. I can tell you that, on average, tariffs for goods exported from the US to EU are about 3%, which is pretty similar to the tariff on goods imported from Europe to America. Under Obama, we tried to negotiate a free trade agreement similar to the Trans-Pacific Partnership with Europe, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. Although, if you thought the TPP was a mess, these negotiations got so bad nothing even got ratified. Now, here's the interesting part, because the White House representative was not buying what the host was selling.
This particular action on steel and aluminum is not about unfair trade practices. It's about national security. As President Trump has said, and he's absolutely correct on this, without an aluminum steel industry, we don't have a country.
Now, that might sound like a bit of an overstatement. I mean, I've heard America makes other things. But that is the logic that some of the administration is using, and there's some reason to it. The national security argument is that, if we go to war, we need some domestic steel manufacturing. I'm not sure if the North Koreans would be willing to sell us tanks for World War III. And if they were, I'm sure we shouldn't be buying them. This means that we should be ready to go to war with anyone, anytime, and keep our domestic steel strong. Now, critics are saying, if the US were engaged in a prolonged military war with a foreign country, we could probably count on Canada, Mexico, and the EU to help us out. But, I don't know. I mean, we really did just screw them on steel tariffs recently.
That if you're trying to deal with unfair steel and aluminum, it's really about China, not about these countries. Is it that China dumps steel into our country through Canada and Mexico, or are you targeting the wrong spot?
Oh man, that's brutal! Is China bringing steel through Mexico or Canada, or is all of this just really stupid? Well, his answer might not inspire as much confidence as I would have hoped.
What we have is about 15 countries in the aluminum space and about 20 in the steel space who basically are sending a flood of imports into this country. Of course, part of the problem is this huge overhang of overcapacity by China, but we've also got the same problem across other countries in the universe.
He's right. We have those problems with China and other countries in the universe. Maybe not the world, but Darth Vader's being a real protectionist dick over all that Death Star steel. In reality, though, he's somewhat right, because if you look at US steel imports, according to CNN Money, this stuff is coming from Canada, South Korea, Mexico, and Brazil a lot more than it's coming from China. So yeah, if you wanted to help domestic steel, you're not going to want to just limit your imports from China. That's like going on a hunger strike by cutting out your mid-afternoon snack. This Fox reporter was really on her game, though, hitting back saying,
but they're giving us cheap steel to build stuff we need. I mean, I think that's the biggest problem when you look at these tariffs.
We use it for everything.
Yeah, the US didn't become the world's largest steel importer because it's shiny. Nope, we use it. We produce about 80 million tons of steel and import about 35 million tons of steel. So yeah. Things would start getting more expensive if we chose to make steel more expensive.
We're going to be rolling in steel, but it's going to be, good pun there, but it's going to be steel and aluminum made with American hands by American men and women at good wages. That'll provide solid tax base to communities like in Appalachia that have been ravaged by the forces of globalization.
Right, Peter, I like that. Foreign countries' metals were a steal. Now that's a good pun too. And now American companies are, of course, adjusting so that they can keep up with demand. I mean, we've stopped buying a ton of steel from them, which has led to the opening of quite a few steel mills in the Midwest. Alright, now to NBC, because despite the fact that we've probably heard all the good arguments against these tariffs, have we had them presented to us in a condescending manner?
Now, the retaliation from some of America's closest allies already underway. Mexico vowing to slap fees on American pork, fruit, and steel. Europe threatening new tariffs on everything from whiskey and motorcycles to denim and cigarettes. Canada's prime minister promising a dollar-for-dollar response.
All right, you can't say Europe is taxing everything from motorcycles to whiskey to cigarettes to denim when that might literally be almost everything. It is very alarming to see this coming from our closest allies, though.
And now, U.S. consumers and businesses bracing for impact.
It could lead to higher prices on everything from beer to automobiles, and that could mean job cuts at some companies.
Well, that's just not funny. Turns out we use steel in a ton of products, so when steel gets more expensive, those products get more expensive, leading to people buying less of it and businesses making smaller profits for every sale. Because their costs went up. Basically, you're not gonna have a good time unless you own or work for a steel company. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedic news, remember to subscribe by clicking here. Or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. And remember to give me a thumbs up. As always, thank you for watching.